Okay, so what we did, we proved two lemmas yesterday, and there's a third lemma still. So I will write this lemma, which is useful. So let X be a topological space. We have a topological space X. X is a topology. And we have a collection of open subsets of X. So let's see. Written, okay? Not so C. Be a collection of open subsets. Of X with the following property, such that. So this is the property. Sometimes this is the definition of basis if the topology is already given, such that. So for each U and U, so this is a condition, for each U and U, so, sorry, for each open set U, so let me give a name here. X, so this is X, oops, with a topology T. Okay? T is a topology. X is topological space. In general, we don't write, but T it's better to write. So it's X topology T. Open set X in T, obviously, no. And each point, for each open set and each point, X and U, there is C in C, so printed. And this is written C, okay? As usual. There's C in C such that X is in C is contained in U. So this is condition. Then the conclusion is. Then C is a basis for a topology. It is a basis since C is a basis for a topology on X. And the topology generated by C is T, is the original topology. Okay? We get the topology which we want. And the topology generated. And the topology generated by C is T, is a given topology T. Okay? So two parts. It is a basis, and it generates a topology, and this topology is the given topology. So it's this condition here. And this is interesting because in some books, you first define topology and then a basis of an already given topology, okay? And then this is a condition, okay? Basis for a topology. This is exactly then the definition of basis for a topology T on X, okay? Which is given. Then this is a condition. Here it's a lemma. Here it's not a definition, but then we say C is a basis in, in our sense, and it generates the topology which we want. Okay. Then C is a basis for a topology on X, and the topology generated by the C is T. This is not T prime. Okay, it looks strange. So C is a basis which generates T. I will not give the details. It's very easy. But The proof, there's two things, proof. The first is C is the basis for a topology. And this is the basis for a topology. For some topology. For topology on X. So here we have our definition. Two conditions, okay? And the two conditions is that each point is in some basis element. So we have this condition here, okay? There is, for each open set, so what is open is X, for example, okay? The whole space is open. So for each point X, in the whole space, we find the basis element. Which goes. So this is part of this definition. That's the case U is X, okay? Then we have the first condition of the, I will not write this, okay? You should follow in some sense. Okay, so the first condition is clear because X is open. And the second condition, what is the second condition? The second condition schematically is you have for a basis, you have two basis elements. I don't write a text here, okay? And you have a point in the intersection. Then you should find a third one. So this was called B1 and B2. And then we find the third one here, which contains a point, and B3 is contained in the same. That's the second condition for the basis, the more important one, okay? However, these are elements now of C, okay? And these are open anyway, okay? These are open. And so the intersection is open. These are open. They are basic, they are elements of C, but important is it's a collection of open subsets, okay? We have to take open subsets. So they are open anyway. So the intersection is open, okay? Given a point in this intersection, which is open, we find a basis element, an element of C which contains the point. Where is it? And it's contained in this open set, no? So also the second condition is true. So it is a basis, okay? And then the second part is that it is a basis. So this is used in exercises very often, okay? You have something and you want to see this is a basis for a topology, if the topology is given already, okay? And then you don't have to prove it is a basis. It follows from this already, okay? It's part of this. It's easy, it's trivial almost, but you don't have to prove, okay? In general, you have to prove that it generates what you want that it generates, okay? So the second part is if T prime is a topology, well, it's maybe too complicated. Generated by C, which is a basis, so it generates a topology, no? Then T is equal to T prime, okay? Then T is equal to T prime. It's the same, okay? That's the second. So these are two easy. Also, this is also very easy. If you want, you have two inclusions, no? T prime, the topology generated by a basis, which is now C. This is a basis now for some topology. The topology, how do we find this topology? There's a definition, of course, no? But we can have a lemma which says we take arbitrary unions of basis elements. That's our topology, okay? The basis elements are open. That's here, okay? They are open anyway in our topology. So arbitrary unions are open, okay, in our topology. So if you take arbitrary unions of elements of C, we remain in our topology. This means that this is one of these inclusions. Which one? So we take arbitrary unions, we get T prime. This is open. Also. So this is certainly in T, okay? Arbitrary unions of open are open. And then we have to prove that any element of T is an arbitrary union. But we have this condition here, okay? We have this condition that each point, if you have an open set and a point, then we find an element of C which contains the point and is contained in the open set. Okay? Then it's clear that it's union of, we get each point, okay? It's union of open sets, okay? So also this is very easy. Except if you have to write it, it's, you have to write something, okay? But this is in some sense the steps of the proof, okay? You should think about this, maybe if, I don't want to write because sometimes, okay, anyway, this is the idea, how do you prove it, okay? The steps, the main steps of the proof are these, okay? And it's a very useful lemma here, which we will use very often, okay? Good, so. Then we have before we do examples, maybe we can define subbases. So this is the third definition. So we have topology, basis, definition, and this is now subbasis. So X is again a set now. Okay, we start with a set. X is a set. A subbasis. Now we want to define subbasis. For a topology, which we still don't know, on X is a collection you can guess how we write this collection. So it's written S now, okay? It's a written T is topology, written B is a basis, written S. It's a collection S, so this is a written S. Hopefully. Is that okay? S? Well, that's how I write written S, okay? It's a collection S. What do you want to define? subbasis. Collection S of subsets of X, of course. Of subsets of X. And we have almost no condition, one small condition, such that whose union equals X. Each element is contained in some of these, whose union is X. So you have the first condition. Each X in X is element is in some each. So you see the notation. Each X in X for each, for each. If you want to write it as a condition, no? For each X in X, there is. So you know, you see, this is S printed, OK? And this is S written such that X is in S. OK, so there's remain one condition. And this is a trivial condition, OK? This is subbasis. So you can take everything almost, OK? If the union is not X, you just add X to what you have. And then, of course, this is trivial, okay? You take also X as one of the elements, and the union is everything. And now we want, of course, a topology. So what we do is, how do we go from subbasis? So subbasis. We have a subbasis S. And then we want to go to a basis, okay? To a basis B. And what do we do? We take finite, these are, should be open sets, no? What we want anyway at the end is S contained in B contained in T, okay? These are all open sets, no? Subbasis is smallest than the basis and the topology. So we take finite intersections. All finite intersections of elements of the subbasis, okay? And then we get the basis. So we have a condition, two conditions now, no? A basis. The first one corresponds finite intersections means that we get S itself, okay? Intersections of one, okay? So we get back of two or three, no? Or finitely many. So S is in B. So this is the first condition of a basis. And the second condition of a basis, well, you take two basis elements, two finite intersections. And you take the intersection. What do you get? Again, a finite intersection. So in this case, we are in the nice situation that the intersection of two basis elements is again a basis element. Okay? So the B3, we take just the whole intersection. Okay? So the second condition is trivial. Okay? It's not always for a basis, but in some cases, the intersection of basis elements is again a basis element. Okay? And this is here the case for this. So the intersection of two finite intersections is a finite intersection. No? That's the point. And then, so it's a basis, and then we have a topology. T. And what should I write here? Arbitrary unions, no? Finite intersections. And that's the lemma. From a basis to the topology, we go by taking arbitrary unions, okay? So arbitrary units. And then we have this, of course, okay? And T is a topology generated, defined in this way, okay? T is a topology generated by the subbasis S, okay? So T is a topology. And B is a basis generated, if you want, also. But T is a topology generated by the subbasis. S. So how to define it, if you have to write? You take arbitrary unions of finite intersections. That's how it's constructed, okay? Arbitrary unions of finite intersections. Arbitrary unions of finite intersections. Okay. Yes. One second, slowly. So you want to say it follows from
Okay. Here we put a condition on S that its union is S.
Yes, yes. That's the only.
Okay. I want to drop this
condition.
This condition. As when we take finite intersections, we can take the intersection of the empty family, and the empty family is a subfamily of S, of course.
What is this intersection of empty family? Empty.
The family which doesn't contain any sets.
Yes.
Its union is of course void, the empty set.
Let's forget. This is very formal, okay? If you want a basis here, the first condition of a basis is exactly this. So then we need it, okay? So we have the same problem for the basis, probably, or. I mean, that's another question. Why is this condition important? Okay, why is it important that any? So if you have an arbitrary point X, we need. In any case, in the topology, the whole space should be open. Okay. And that means that each element is contained in an open set. Should be if not in another, then in the whole space, in the whole. Okay. So say again what you. I mean, it's very formal. This is not. But this is let's say this is a good condition. Okay. Of course, you can. play a game with conditions and relax a little bit and see what remains, okay? But for topology, if you have a point, we want also have neighborhoods of a point, open sets which contains a point, okay? Otherwise, I don't know what you get. Nothing interesting because it didn't occur in mathematics, right? So the condition is, okay.
The only thing I get here is I can take any arbitrary subfamily.
You can take any?
Arbitrary.
Yes.
Subfamily of P of X, which is the power set of X, okay?
Yes.
And, okay, generate a topology for which this any arbitrary subfamily of P of X is the subbasis.
Yeah.
So, subsets of X can generate.
But let's say to this, okay? Well, maybe we can discuss after lecture. But it's better to stay with the clear things, not to. Of course, it's a nice game to relax conditions and to see what remains. If it's useful, is another thing. No, and then. Okay, these are the conditions. Okay, three conditions for a topology. Two conditions for a basis, one condition for a subbasis. Now we should discuss examples. This is more, well, it's not, I don't know if it's more interesting, but it's, oops. So we have a long list of examples now, of topologies, of bases, and so on and so on. Some you may know, and others maybe not, but okay. So what is the first example? So we have to talk about, yeah, an important example in the book is the order topology. So let me start with the order topology. So X now is a set, but it's an ordered set. What means ordered? Let X be, and so there are various words. I forgot even the word in the book. So it's a linear order, total order. So there are various words. So an ordered set. Let X be an ordered set. And ordered means, for us, complete order. Linear order, okay? So there are various words for this. It's not clear for me which is linearly ordered. Linearly or ordered. Or a complete order. I'll say what it is, of course. A complete order. That's ordered. Because otherwise, it's called partially ordered, okay? If it's not this order, then it's only partially ordered. What mean does it mean? So this means that we have an order relation, no? Which is this symbol, okay? And here we have to be careful now. This means smaller, okay? If you want smaller equal, so this is smaller. And if you write this, or just this, this is smaller or equal. That's not the same, okay? Smaller or equal. Because for some other relation, this is inclusion, okay? Inclusion means strictly included or equal, okay? If you recall, this means both, okay? If you want that it's different, then, so here it's used in a different, okay? Well, anyway. So what means total order? If X, Y are in X, and they are different elements, then if you have two different elements, then we can compare. Then X is smaller than Y, or Y is smaller than X. So we can compare any two elements. That's the total order, okay? we can compare any two elements. That's what we want always. Otherwise, we have to say partially all. Okay? And then there's one. So also, this is also sort of strange. So x smaller than x does not hold, okay, in this order, okay? X smaller than x is not true, okay? X is not smaller than x. It's equal to x, but not smaller. Does not hold. And then there's one important condition, which is the transitivity. Now, if so, the important condition is this: now, if x is smaller than y, and y is smaller than z, then x is smaller than z. Okay, this is the important condition, which is always used. Okay, this is an ordered set, a completely linear or linearly ordered or totally ordered or whatever set. And now we want, so the example, of course, are the reals, okay? Example, this, the main example are the real numbers, no? And now in analysis, the standard topology, which we didn't define still, but what do you take for a basis for the standard topology on R? You take open intervals. That will be a basis, not the topology, but a basis. Now, this is a basis which defines the standard topology. Open intervals, okay? And this is a basis. Because the intersection of two open intervals, what is it? It may be empty, or it's again an open interval. So in this case, again, the intersection of two basis elements is either empty or is a basis element, okay? This is, I will write the definition later, but this is a standard topology, okay? And now we do the same here, okay? We have an arbitrary ordered set, so we take a we define a basis. So what do? We take open intervals, okay? So we take x, y, x smaller than y. So of course, x, y in x. So what is this? This is our notation for open interval. And these are all points z in x, such that, of course, it's between x and y. That is between x and y. That's an open interval, OK? And this is our notation for an open interval. So somebody always write, is used to this, and then they go on writing this. No, this has also some sense to write this, because this is sometimes used for other notation. No, but in the book, and we follow this for an open interval. So open interval. And now we have already the problem, OK? This is, in general, not a basis. We don't get something. Because example, we can take here the interval, whatever, 0, 1. This is ordered, OK? It's a subset of ordered is ordered, OK? So this is ordered. And now we have this as a set, no? And we take this. And then we have a problem. Because then these two points are in no open interval in this set. OK? So it's not a basis, all this is what we see. OK? The first condition is not valid. OK? So we have to be careful. So union. So we have to add. For the real, this is sufficient. OK? But if there's the smallest element, then we have a problem. And then we have to add something. So we take x0, y, x0 smaller than y, if x has the smallest element, x0. If it exists, okay, a smallest element. If it exists, it's unique, of course, no? Because we have a complete order, no? There's one, but maybe no. If x has a smallest element, so what is this? This is a half open interval, okay? Half open interval. So these are all points z such that z is small, bigger equal to x0 and smaller than y. Okay. So here's, it includes this point. Okay. So you know, you see how to write intervals, no? Closed intervals. Of course, then it's clear that we have to add something still if there's a largest element. We have the same problem. So we take y, well, let's take x, y0, and here now, okay? If, so again, x smaller than y0, if x has the largest element, y0, okay? If x has the largest element. Y0, then we have to add these two. Then B is the basis, okay? So, I don't, yes. Then B is the basis. It's a basis which generates, by definition, the order topology, okay, associated to the given order, which generates. And this is called the order topology. Of course, associated to the given order, okay? Other order, other topology, probably. It's not so clear. Associated. Associated to the given order, of course. So this is the definition of order. It is a basis, no? Because every element is in some of these, okay? And then we need these two, if you have a largest or smallest element. And the intersection of two basis elements is empty, maybe, if it's not empty. It's, again, of one of these three types. The intersection of two open intervals is an open interval, or empty. The intersection of this and this, well, you have it's clear. You see the various cases now, and you always get an interval. Or it's empty, OK? By picture, if you want, no? You make a picture. You have a smallest element than this, OK? And now you intersect with the same. If you intersect with the largest element, then this is an open, okay? That's one possibility, and so on, okay? So make a picture of all possibilities, okay? That's all interesting. Good. So this is the basis, and this is. Yes? No, 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 no. This picture, you mean? No, I like to, if I have an ordered space, I make always this picture. Because it's a linear, it might be R, yes. Okay, it looks like it's a reals, okay? But I make also for an arbitrary ordered space, no, X. Of course, it's not a continuum or something in general. That's clear, no? Because what is ordered is the natural numbers, no? All subsets, no, are ordered. So the natural numbers, the rational numbers, whatever, okay? And but you see they come one after the other, okay? Maybe it's not everywhere, something I'm missing or something like that. But for an ordered set, I like to make this picture, okay? It's linear. It's linearly ordered, okay? Maybe some points are missing here or something like that. But it's in general for. It's just a picture, okay, to and then I can intervals, right? It's like for the reals, okay? I have this interval, I have these intervals, I have these intervals, and I have closed intervals, okay? It's the same for the reals, but it's for arbitrary linear order. Schematic picture. So this is the order topology. And then there's a strange example. No, let's see. First, sorry, 1 second. Something. Well, I define the order topology, and I should define. Okay, so here's a very strange example, but it will be important in a certain. So, well. So, example. Of course, if you take the reals with a natural order, you get the standard topology, okay? If you take the natural, so, well, I take R2 now, R2, this is R cross R. So you don't see a natural order, okay? The plane has no order, okay? It's not a line, no? But we have an order, of course. So we take the, how is it called in the book? We take the, what?
Like absolute value
modulus? No, not so complicated. Maybe not an analysis. We take the dictionary order or the lexicographic order. What is the name of the book? Dictionary, okay? We take the dictionary order. Or if you want lexicographic order, okay? It's the same. So, it's like the lexicon, okay? You have two letters only here, okay? You have all words have first letter, second letter, okay? And you can compare as a lexicon. That's first, you look at the first, then each R has a natural order, okay? It reals, if you don't say anything, it's a natural order. So what does it mean? Now, how to write elements? And this is another feature of the book. So I take two elements, x, and now you say, you write, don't write that, okay? This is, would be an element here sometimes, okay? X, y. But this is also an open interval. So we get some confusion here, okay? So in the book, he writes elements of a product, not in this way, but in this way. X times Y, let X times Y, X1 times Y1, okay? And X2 times two elements. X2 times Y2 be in R cross R. And that's the way how we write this, okay? Not as an interval, but otherwise we have some confusion between the two notations. So then, x1 cross y1, so these are two words, smaller than x2 cross y2, if. So it's a lexicon, okay? You look at the first letter. If x1 is smaller, then x2, it comes first in the book, okay, in the lexicon, the first letter. Or they might be equal, no? And then you look at the second letter. And y1, it's smaller than y2. If they are also equal, then they are equal anyway, okay? So this is the lexicographic order, or the dictionary order, on R cross R. What topology do we get? We get, in some sense, a strange topology. So let's have a look at this topology. There will be one important example which comes from this topology. So the basis are what? Open intervals, no, okay? Because we have no smallest element, no largest element, no, in this case. Open intervals. No, 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 no rectangles. One second. The order topology, okay? There are open intervals or half open if you have a smallest or largest element, okay? We don't have a smallest, largest element here, clearly, because in R there's nothing, okay? And so there are open intervals, okay? Bases are open intervals. That's the definition, okay? The other two we don't need because we don't have smallest element, we don't have large. So they are just open intervals. Open intervals now, we have x1 cross y1. Now we have both notations, no? This is one of these elements. And then the second point is x2 cross y2. This is an open interval, and these are the two elements, okay? So this must be smaller than this, okay? An open interval. And there are two cases. So let's have a look. How do they look like? Okay, they have two cases. We may have x1 equal to x2, okay? So if x1 is equal to x2, then y1 is smaller than y2, because this is smaller than this, okay? So we have here what is y1, y2, y1, no? Okay. And so we have this point here. This is x1 cross y1. And this is x1 cross y2, which is x2. And so we get this open interval. All points between these two points, okay, which are indicated in this way. This is an open interval, okay, in R2. In R2, no. Okay, on this line, okay? So that's is open interval if they are equal, x1 equal to x2. If they are different, if x1 is smaller than x2, so now we have a different case, x1 and it's smaller than x2, no? Then I don't care too much about y1, y2, no, not important, no, okay, for the order. So here's the one point, x1 cross y1 and y2, I don't know. It might be wherever, okay, here maybe, okay, x2 cross y2. But it might be also here above, okay. So what is the interval now between these two, okay? The interval is, so we take everything which is larger than this and smaller than this, okay? So we go on this coordinate, okay? So this point is not there, no, it's an open interval. But if we go here on this line, then it gets larger and larger, okay? The second coordinate, no? The first one remains. So we get everything here, which is above here, okay? But we are not we did not arrive here, of course, no? Then we go to the left, to the right, okay, a little bit. So all these points here, all these lines, the complete lines here, no? Right? They are, all these points are larger than this, but still smaller than this one, okay? And how does it end? Well, it's clear that it ends in this way, okay? So you get this, then you get all the lines between, and then you finish with this. This is the largest. If you go here, then it's out of the interval, okay? So it looks like this, okay? Strange set. It's not a rectangle. Open rectangles are the standard topology of R2. This is another topology. This is open, no? This is a basis element. This is basis element. So this is open now, okay? In particular, it's open, this one. And what you see is this suffice. You don't need the second one, okay? You can take only the first one. Because if you have these, you have these anyway. If you take, these are so are sufficient, the first type of intervals. Because the second type is a union of the first type. No? Each point here, you easily get of the first type. Each point here, you easily get something of the first type. Now, each point here, you get something here. So for the topology, you need only this. You take arbitrary unions, no? But you get these anyway, OK? So you have these also. So to generate the topology, intervals. So we have a smaller basis, okay? So we take just these, okay? And then you think, is this a basis? So each point is in some of these, yes, no problem. The intersection of two of these, in general, is empty, no? If it's not empty, it's one of these again, okay? So this is a basis, okay? So we have a smaller basis, okay? So to generate the topological intervals of type, so x cross y1, x cross y2 suffice. You can take this. This is already a basis. OK. That's a strange example, but we will see this again, OK? So it's not just an example. it's in some sense important. Well, it's clear, okay? We have R2 with a strange order. Not a strange order. R2 has no natural order in some sense, no? No geometric order, okay? Like a line, okay? So we have the lexicographic order, the dictionary order, and this gives a topology in R2, okay? This is a dictionary order topology on R2. So this is an example, which we will see again. OK, so what? So this was the order topology, and I was confused because, but it doesn't matter. There's another example which is important in the book, which is the lower limit topology on R. So we have many examples, as I said. No? And now we have two topologies, the standard topology. So we compare two topologies, the standard topology and the lower limit topology. So this is limit topology. And here we take the reals, okay? So we have the standard topology, and we have another topology, which is called lower limit topology on the reals. This is also an important example. I mean, the standard topology is the most important topology, but so we take a basis, B. For the standard topology, as we said, we take open intervals, okay? So x, y. So recall, this is an open interval again, no? Open interval. Real interval now, okay? We are in the reals. X smaller than y. X, y in R. Is a basis which generates the standard topology by definition. That's our definition. That's the easiest way to define the standard. It's a basis for a topology which generates the standard topology. And I emphasize, this is the easiest definition of the standard topology. Okay, this defines the standard by definition. Okay, this defines the standard topology. This is the definition of the standard topology for us. The definition of the, well, it's clear from analysis of the standard topology. That's the definition. Okay. That's the standard topology. And the lower limit now. The lower limit, you just change a little bit. So you take b prime. And now you said, well, lower limit. I take x, y. I take not open intervals, but half open intervals. And again, x smaller than y. X, y, we are in the reals. We are on the reals here. And now you think about this, and what you see, well, it's a basis again, no? The intersection of two of these is again of the same type, or empty, okay? So it's, this is a basis. This is a basis also. The intersection of two of these is again of this type, no? If you don't think, you make, I mean, I like to see geometrically, no? I make these pictures, no? Now it's the reals, but it's good for any space, okay? So you this is a picture of a half open interval, no? And you take two of these, and what you see is intersection is again of this, okay? It might, of course, be empty, no? So it's somewhere here, or it might be include the other one, but in all cases, it's no problem. So it's a basis. And this is a lower limit topology, which generates. By definition, the lower limit topology. On the reals. So this is lower limit topology on the reals. And this is standard topology. And then you have an observation. So can you compare these topologies? What would you say? What is the relation between these two topologies, the standard and the lower limit? Yeah. Yeah, well, compare high means finer, strictly finer, coarser, strictly coarser.
The standard topology is finer than lower limit.
No. So the lemma, if you want, then. No, no. The lower limit topology is strictly finer than the standard. The lower limit topology is strictly finer than the standard topology. The lower limit on the reals, we are on the reals here, no? We are on the reals. And this lower limit topology on R is strictly finer than the standard topology. On R, but for other, we have no standard topology. Standard topology is for the reals for the moment. For R2, we still didn't define, okay? There's also a standard topology. So proof by picture. So we have to prove two things, no? We have to prove finer, okay? So finer, okay? It's finer, and then strictly. So finer, we have a lemma, okay? We have two bases, okay? And yesterday, the last lemma was a lemma which compares two topologies, okay? Finer, apply a lemma. Well, I don't give numbers here, but apply this lemma, last lemma yesterday. And what does it say? So there was this condition, no? So let me, for each a basis element, schematically, okay? We are on the reals now anyway, okay? So finally, these are the reals and not some strange other space. So for we want to prove that the lower limit topology is finer than the standard topology. So we take an element of the standard topology. okay? A basis element of the standard topology, okay? This is an open interval. Standard topology, open intervals. And we take a point. Okay? Then we should be able to find a half open interval. Yes, exactly. And then the lemma says, then it's finer. What interval you take is clear, no? You take the interval. This is AB, no? Well, you take XB, no? That's a, so you take XB, okay? So X is in XB, and this is contained in AB, okay? And this implies finer. The lemma then says it's finer, okay? This is a picture which says finer. Without writing. Okay?
How?
Sorry?
How?
Well, we proved the lemma yesterday. And the lemma is this condition.
Okay, okay. Yeah, I know, but intuitively.
No, intuitively it's that it's finer. This?
Yeah.
I mean,
but.
Any open interval is a union of half open intervals. On the left. Because any point you find. No, it's okay. Okay. Any open interval is a union of half open intervals. Right? For each point in the open interval, you have a half open interval, no? So it's okay, right. Anyway, that's a proof, okay? This is a picture for a proof. And we proved the lemma yesterday, so. No, it shouldn't be strange, okay? You say half open intervals are too special or something. Open intervals are better. Well, if you have half open intervals in a basis, then you have all open intervals anyway, okay? Because there are unions of this half. So now we have to prove strictly finer, okay? And that's clear or not. So strictly finer. That's the second. Finer we have, no? But strictly. So what means strictly finer? It means there's one open set which is not open in the standard. But now you say any half open interval is not open in the standard, no? Clear, right? So I take any. This is open in the lower limit, okay? This is open in the lower limit. It's a basis element, no? Half open interval, open in the lower limit. Right? It's a basis element. In fact, it's a basis element, okay? A basis element. They are open. Basis elements are open. And this doesn't look open in the standard, no? Nobody would say that's an. Not an open interval, it's an half open interval. But there's only one point where it goes wrong, okay? Now we apply again the lemma, okay? Which the same lemma, we apply a lemma, okay? So we take AB, okay? The point A, of course, is the only problem, okay? There is no open interval. It's clear that A, there's no open interval which contains A, which is contained in AB, okay? Because in open interval, we have to go to both sides, okay? So there's no open interval containing A and contained in A. That's clear, no? That's trivial. And now the lemma says, then the standard topology is not finer than the lower limit, okay? It cannot be finer than Lorentz. So they are not equal. So this is an example of an open set, open in the lower limit topology, a basis element, but not open in the standard. Well, it's trivial, no? The standard is a topology from analysis. And so we don't need even the lemma here, probably. Well, anyway. Yes?
Let's take the operator from 1 to 2.
What?
Let's take the operator from 1 to 2.
The open interval from 1 to 2, yes.
How can it be an open set in the lower limit topology?
Is that true? Or? Sorry. Yes. These are basis elements of the lower limit, no? And I take the union over all n. So it comes clear, arbitrarily close to 1, OK? But we don't get 1.
No,
we want it to be larger than 1. Plus, it's plus, yes. That's 2, right? So it's clear that this is open in the lower limit. It's a union of this kind of stuff, no? Right?
But it is clear when we take another point, when you take a point in one in the open interval.
Yeah, you can take 1.5. No, that's
yes.
A point in me. For each point, you have a half open interval. That's what we said here, all right? Yeah. But he says it's not. This is a proof, but it's strange, no? And then he wants to see that one of two, maybe. But it's this, okay? So it's. Yeah, this was the other, okay, right. Yeah. So it's strictly finer, okay? The lower limit Rn. And this is an important example in the book. This is the first. There are 4 or 5 examples which are all over the book, and this is the first. So RL, then we write RL. L, R with the lower limit topology. OK, this is it. R with the lower limit. And this is one of the most important examples in the book. It's a strange space, but it's important. It's a lower limit topology. You will see it again and again. And R, if you write just this, no? This means R is the standard topology, OK? If you don't write anything, and this is topological space, then it's a standard, OK? R is the standard topology. So if you don't give an index or something, it's just standard topology. Good. This is, well, next example. So this we see everything again and again. So it's good to get used to order topology, to lower limit topology, you know, but these are easy generalizations of, then you say, of course, lower limit. If you have lower limit topology, it's clear that we have a upper limit topology, no, on R. By the same argument, and the lower and upper limit topology, they are incomparable. Yeah, that's true. They are incomparable. And it's just a matter of choice. Okay, you choose one of these, and it's the lower. As well, you might always take the upper, okay? So in the book, you don't find the upper, you find the lower. But the upper limit topology, then you would have this kind, okay? That's the upper limit topology, no? But it's for us, one is enough. So upper limit. So this would be something like upper limit topology, no? Okay, a basis. And this is not comparable to lower limit, okay? They're incomparable, not comparable. To the lower limit topology. Well, you see this by picture, no? You just take this one. This is what lower limit, okay? And then for this, this is a crucial point, no? And for this one, you don't find any element of the other type which contains this point is contained here. I mean, you can go to the other side, but you have to go here in some sense, okay? You go out, okay? So this is, and the same for the other, no? You have this for the upper, okay? And this is for the lower limit, this is a bad point. Because if you now want the lower limit, you have to take this, maybe this point itself, but you have to go here somewhere, okay, with the lower. So they are not comparable. This is a picture, okay? This shows that the, well, you need two pictures, no?
If you take one, two.
Where, here, low, this?
No, no.
The other one?
Yes. Okay. And two, three.
This?
No.
The other one?
Yes. The intersection is two.
Yes.
And we have not a basis element.
Which contains? Right. So you want to give another proof of this, in some sense, yeah. And then, of course, you may take if something, but then you say, why not take also closed intervals? No? Okay, but this is not interesting. Why not? If you take all closed intervals, it's the basis again. No? You get now you can have smaller equal to y, no? So you get points. No? Okay. A point is a closed interval, right? So what is the topology in this case, if you take this? All closed intervals is a basis. What is the topology? Points. Discrete, yes. It's a discrete topology. So this generates discrete topology. So A is equal to AA, no? Points are closed intervals. This one. So this is not nothing new, okay? This is not so interesting, discrete. By the way, what is these are almost exercises now. What is the most efficient? So you have a topology and you want to find a good basis. For the discrete topology, it's clear. What is for each topology has a basis, okay? What? You take all open sets. That's the basis also, okay? Not very efficient, no? You take everything, all open sets. That's the basis for the topology, okay? For the discrete topology, you have a smallest basis. What is this?
Singletons,
single points. Yeah. That's the most efficient basis. Any basis has to contain single points of the discrete topology, must contain single points, okay? Because they are open. Okay, and this is sufficient to generate everything, no? Everything is open, so singletons, yeah. That's the most efficient basis for the discrete topology, okay? In general, okay. So, other examples. It's in some sense, it's very often nicer to discuss examples, no? And but we have to go on with other examples, important, more important examples, which you know, more standard examples. So the next one is the product topology. So the product topology. On a product, x cross y. So this, I will define the product topology. No. on x plus y. So x and y are now topological spaces already, okay? Topological spaces. And we want to define a topology on x cross y. So if you don't know this, you think, well, what is the... Well, you have, of course, R2, no? This from analysis, again, no? R cross R, no? The standard topology, you talk of open rectangles, no? These are open, open rectangles are products, no? Of open intervals. So that's what we... so this is a topology. This is open rectangles. It's not a, a topology. That's the basis only, no? Because, okay, so we take as a basis, which is called, so the product topology. So we take B, we define it by a basis, no? Okay. So we take products open times open. So u times v, u open in x, and v open in y. So in some sense, this is this is a basis. It's not a topology. It's a basis only. It's a basis which generates. And that's the definition of the product, which generates the product topology. That's the definition of the product topology on x cross y. That is the definition. Why is it a basis? Well, schematically, each point, of course, is contained in some of these. X cross y, for example, is here. Or x cross y. It's a, so the first condition is, as usual, fulfilled trivially. The second condition is you have two, the intersection of these. So it's a basis. So u1 cross v1 intersection, the second one, u2 cross v2. So now it's set theory, no? What is this? U1 intersection U2. Times V1 intersection V2. So it's again the product, okay? So here we have the intersection of two basis elements is a basis element. Here the empty set is also empty times empty or something, no? Empty, the empty set is here. But so intersection. The intersection of two basis elements is again a basis element. So we are in this situation. Every now and then it happens. It doesn't happen always, no, because if you take open balls, then it doesn't happen. No. The intersection of two open balls is not an open ball. So it's a basis. The picture, by the way, is this, no? So I like these schematic pictures. Now you have this, and you have this, and you see this formula. Okay, of course you have this is u1, this is v1, and this is u2, and this is v2. No, and this is a picture for this, right? The intersection is u1 intersection u2 times V1 intersection V2. Okay? So this is an illustration of this, okay? Of this set theoretic formula. It's better to see sometimes, okay? You make a picture and it's maybe it's not right. This is V1, this is U1, this is U2, and this is V2. Now it looks somewhat better. Okay. So this is the definition of the product topology. Now, we have a lemma which is useful. small lemma. Suppose we have a basis for x and for y, okay? So, by the way, in general, it's only a basis, not the topology, no? Already for the R2, okay? A union of open rectangles is not an open rectangle, no? Open sets in R2 are very complicated, okay? You cannot describe directly, okay? You can describe these products, maybe. But even this you cannot describe, maybe, okay? Because these are all open sets. So we take basis. So, lemma. If I should use this notation, we have a basis for x. If I see it. If bx is a basis for x, let me write it this way, changing notation. If bx is a basis for x, for the topology of x, for the given topology of x, and by is a basis for y, for the given topology on y, then we don't have to take everything, so I have to take b prime now. This is b, okay, and now we have b prime. And what I take is not all products of offsets, but only for basis, of basis elements. So u prime times v prime, u prime times v prime, where u prime is open, but it's in bx. And v prime is in by. So we just take products of basis elements. It's a basis for the product topology. Oh, I have to go on here. It's a basis of the product topology. X cross Y. Well, maybe we can prove. So, yeah, I will not prove everything, but every now and then, so proof. So we apply the first lemma, okay? Apply a lemma. That's the first lemma today, no? So what did this lemma say? We take, we have a collection of open sets. That was the first lemma today, no? Collection of open sets, such that, and the condition was, given any open set and a point, we find an element of this collection which contains a point is contained, okay? This is this. Any open set, any point, we find an element of this collection which will be the basis, which, so it's so then let's do it, okay, step by step, it's trivial then. So let W be open in x cross y. And we need a point, no? Which is called x cross y in W, and x cross y element in W. Okay. By the definition of the product topology, maybe you find this boring to write, but you have to be able to write this, okay? Without thinking too much, no? It should be almost automatic. By the definition of the product topology on x cross y. So let you think, what is the definition, no? The definition is something is open. If given a point, arbitrary point, you shouldn't find a basis element which contains a point is contained. where the basis is the basis which defines. Okay, so by the definition of the product topology on X plus Y, there exists.
There are U open in X. Let me write it shorter. There is, so U cross V in, what was the name of the basis? B, which defines, okay? In B, some element here in B, such that our point, which is it? X cross Y is contained in U cross V, and this is
that's the definition of the topology generated by a basis. Okay? This is the definition. And then it's a lemma that the topology generated is a union of all basis elements. But that's a lemma, okay? The definition was this. You may change, of course, no? Take the other as a definition, and then you have this also, of course. Okay, so it's clearly equivalent, such that it. So what does it mean? X is in U, Y is in V. But this is open in X, no? Because we are in B. Open times open. So open in X, this is open in Y. By the definition of the basis B, no? But now we have a basis of X, right? Which is BX. So there is so X is in U, U is open, we have a basis. So there is a U prime in B, the basis for X, such that X is in U prime, is contained in U, because this is a basis. And there is V prime in BY, such that, where is it? Y is contained in V prime, is contained in V. Again, by the definition of the topology generated by a basis, no? It's the same definition always. So then, finally, what we have, then X cross Y is contained in U prime, which is contained in U times V, which is contained in W. And this now is an element of? Exactly, B prime. And now the lemma says, so now this lemma, which we started with, the lemma then says, no, the lemma which I wrote in the beginning, and the proof is very easy, but it's very useful, no? The lemma says then B prime is a basis which generates the same topology, the product topology. B prime is a basis which generates the product topology. And that's the end of the of this proof, okay? Apply definitions. Example is example, important example, of course. R2. R cross R. This is a product. The standard topology in R2 is the product topology, okay? But that's the standard topology. That's a definition. On R2, which is R cross R, is a product topology. So each R has a standard, okay? The standard one is a product topology.
That's a possible definition
of the standard topology in R2. The standard. So what is the basis?
Yeah, now we have open rectangles.
The lemma which we proved before, no, the preceding lemma says, now we have a basis here, which are open intervals. So bases are open rectangles. Okay, now a basis, it has a basis which is open product of open intervals. So xy, x1, sometimes it's not so good to give bases are open rectangles. Which are products of open intervals, no? Okay. So we just have this. Okay. Open interval times open interval, no? I didn't give names here because that's sometimes. So this is standard topology. And this is a basis which is, this is a basis very easy to describe. Open rectangles, okay? The topology is very complicated, no? Because open sets are extremely complicated in R2, you know? I mean, you have almost everything you, I mean, this is R2, no? And now you take something which is extremely complicated, but open. What means open? This is open. Open means you take any point here, wherever you take, you find a basis element which an open rectangle which contains a point is contained in this. Okay, so you cannot describe explicitly open sets in R2. You can this basis is very simple. Okay. Yes. Products of two open intervals. Yeah. Right. Okay. So now we have also the standard topology in R2. No? Then R3, we can go on, okay, for finitely many. What else? Nothing else. Well, one example which might be interesting. Well, we have 3 minutes, this is always. So a strange example, it's an exercise almost example. So we take R2 with the lower limit, with the so now, two, we have the standard topology now, okay? But we have this other topology, which is dictionary order topology, okay? This strange topology. Lexicographic or dictionary order topology. Order topology, the dictionary order topology. By the way, now we can compare. The first exercise would be compare it with a standard topology. Now, can we compare these two topologies, the dictionary order and the standard topology? So one has to think a little bit. Now we have only 1 minute, but yes, we can compare. And the answer is it's strictly finer again than the standard. It's strictly finer. Hopefully, yes. It's strictly finer than the standard topology. This is not a good sentence. R2 with the dictionary topology is strictly, the dictionary topology is strictly finer than the standard topology. Than the standard topology. So better sentence, the dictionary topology, order topology on R2 is pretty funny. That's better from grammar, OK. So let me 1 minute. This is an exercise. So we make the same kind of picture, no? We want to compare. So we have finer and strictly finer, no? Finer. So finer. We have a basis for both, no? We have to take a basis element of the standard topology. And we take the best basis we can describe best. This is open rectangles, OK? So take an open rectangle. This is open rectangle. So it doesn't contain this border, no? Right? Open rectangle. This is open rectangle. And now, given a point, of course, we find this vertical line here, no? This. And this is the basis for the lower limit. So this picture says finer, OK? For any point, it's clear that we can find this vertical line, OK? And then strictly finer again, OK? So strictly finer. Then we have to find just one open set, which is not open in the other one, OK? And of course, each of these intervals, no? That doesn't look, that doesn't look open in the standard, no? You take any point, and you have basis rectangles, open rectangles. If you take an open rectangle here, the only thing which you can do is something like this, no? But you cannot stay on the line, OK? So this is the picture for strictly finer, OK? It's not possible. This is for finer, OK? So they are comparable. The other one, the standard is the standard, the good topology, the other one is topology which we will see anyway, OK? So we get used to it, OK? But the last question for today, sorry. So the dictionary order topology, we can describe in a different way now. We have product topologies. So the standard topology is a product topology, R cross R, OK? R2 is R cross R. All standard, OK? Here, it is everything standard. Now we have R2 with a dictionary. And now the last question for the day, which is interesting. Is this a product topology also? Can we? It's not the standard, no? R cross R, that's clear. But it is also a product, which one? Yes, exactly. Or better, discrete with R, OK? Yeah, exactly. So this is, in fact, R. Exactly. RD cross R. And this is RD with a discrete topology. What is the basis for the discrete topology? Points. Singletons, points. What is the basis here? Intervals. What is the product of a point with an interval? It's one of these guys, you know? This is a point times an interval, right? So we get exactly, so this is also, in some sense, the dictionary on R2 is nothing else than the product topology, R cross R, where the first R is a discrete, and the second is the standard, OK? That is another description of the, that's sort of nice, right? So we have an example. But as I said, the main example in the book is this one, RL, okay, which we will see again and again. And the dictionary order on R2 itself, but a certain subspace of this will be one of the main examples also in the book. So this we will see again and again also, okay? But I will describe next week.